When did you first know you were funny?
Well, let's see. I don't think they called it funny. I think they called it goony when I first knew. When I first knew I was goony, I was probably about 8.
And were you like, were you a performer, or were you like a?
Let's see.
For your family.
Yeah, I goofed around. You know, I did, and I. Yeah, and I always loved comedy. I was always, a fan of comedy for, once it got to the formative years. And
Who were your people when you were coming up?
Show of Shows was amazing. Mm. I there would be comic novelists that I wrote, that I read and loved. I loved theater in general. But comedy plays. So reading Kaufman, Hart, and Kaufman, and.
So did that sitcom structure come easily to you? Was that a?
No, I want to take that question seriously. Maybe. I mean, I just never said it to myself before, but, because I early on, I was allowed to be in charge of a show very early on in my writing life. I guess I had a year and a half freelancing, and then I had a show on the air. And I did do it. I had a great director producer who was my boss in the first show, and that was a great learning ground. And everything's been a great learning ground.
Did you think you were king of the walk at that point, or did you?
No. I thought I was. Listen, this is a common experience with people who write, because I've asked a lot of writers this. Mm-hmm. It takes you at least a decade before somebody says to you, what do you do for a living? And you could say, I'm a writer, without saying, I'm a writer, It does take you that long because so many that I've talked to can't believe that that's going to be something that can happen in their lives.
But it happened pretty quick for you, all things considered.
It's not like I went for it. I mean, I had a job in a newsroom, and I was doing news writing, but then I left to come here, and then I was unemployed for a while, and it was very scary, and then I just met a guy named Alan Burns at a party who was a successful television writer, and he led me to my first break, and we ended up being partners for a while.
Huh. So he taught you the ropes of the business side of it? Is that the general?
We became writing partners, so it wasn't, but he just was very generous to me to help me become a freelancer, and then as fates would have it, we became writing partners later on.
Mm. So you had great success. When was it that you first started taking on that role of kind of having new people come in and kind of shepherding in new talent? Because that's a big part of this movie. Is that another, you've brought on another?
Well, it's you're always, in television, you're always on the lookout for writers. You're always trying to build a writing staff. That's a continuum. It happens all the time. You keep working with people. They're successful. They go off. They have their own shows. This is a whole cycle. You're looking for new people again. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's been amazing with The Simpsons that we have, that we have new blood coming in all the time. But it's amazing how many of us were there at the beginning or close to it.
Well, that seems like it's been 8 or 9 cycles of, like, full crews of writers already on that show.
Yes, but there's been, there are maybe 5 of us who were there on day one, and which is a lot, and other people who've been, a lot of people have been there for a while, and new people come in all the time. In movies, it's always been when a writer has a new voice, and that's always the only time that, that I produce a movie.
Hmm.
And it sounds, as I hear it come out of my mouth, it sounds pretentious in a certain way. But when you try and figure out, if you have like a little company, which we have a little company, and why do you have a little company? Our reason from day one was always to give writers authority over their script. All the jokes about Hollywood screenwriters, mm-hmm. and how they get rewritten, how they get tossed aside, how there are a number of them. We've never done that, and it looks like we will never do that. Mm. Where every original writer sees no writer has ever been rewritten by anybody else, and they've always had a strong voice. If they didn't direct the picture, they produced it. They stayed with it till the end. that's what we always do. So
you were never anxious to build up like as big as Castle Rock or something like that?
No, we go years and we don't make a movie, and it's you know, it's fine.
So what was it like when you first read Wes Anderson?
I think I first saw like a 10-15 minute short that was the birth of Bottle Rocket as a full length script, and then I read the longest full length script anybody ever wrote, and then I went to Texas, and they had never, even though living on the same floor was Wes and his co-writer and the star, all the stars of the movie, and the Wilson brothers, and you know, and Owen, who had written it with him, they had never read the script out loud, and they'd been sitting with it for about a year. And I said, let's read it. Everybody's here, let's read it. The reading was the longest reading we ever, I mean, you could have become pregnant and given birth during that reading. It went on where you couldn't believe it. It was comical. And I remember I went out at the end of it, and it was just seriously that, you know, that some work had to be done, certainly some cutting, and then maybe some things here and there. And Wes kept on saying, you're gonna make the movie? And I said, well, you know what I think we should do? Why don't you come to Los Angeles and we'll talk to each other and you're gonna make the movie? You're gonna make the movie? And to the point where you realize that it wasn't a question you'd handle. It was a question where it was so what this means to me that you had to answer it with your deepest truth, and you're gonna make the movie, and I said, I don't know. And it was like that. And then they came and hung out for a year, and then we made the movie.
So was that, did you have any sense, it was just the words at that point with Wes? Because the visual of Wes was apparent in Bottle Rocket, but not to the degree to which it became. The style, that kind of like extreme style. As a director,
he was a director. He would have killed himself if he didn't end up directing films. I mean, it was just what he had to do, and he had met Owen in a playwriting class, and it was so curious working with them because you could never spot the writing process. So most of our meetings would be, I'd end up pitching my guts out while they listen, you know, and wonder what they take away, but it was, you know, Wes was always Wes, which is a great thing to be.
So what was it like when you read Kelly's first script?
It wasn't about Kelly's first script. It was about meeting Kelly after reading her first script, and she impacted me, impressed me. And we never looked at that script again. And then we hung out and talked about everything. I mean, almost had sort of a great idol together. I mean, we'd go to, Larry Moss is a great acting coach. We'd go sit in the back of his classroom and just get religion. We'd have lunch with somebody who was great at their job in movies and just talk. And then I urged research on her, and it turned out she was a born reporter, born journalist, because she'd go out, she'd talk to young women, and she'd be empathic. She'd ask the right questions, she'd bring back videos. So we developed a sense of mission, a sense of responsibility to what we were doing. And then 2 years later, she came in with, call it whatever you want, second draft, first draft, you know, rebirth. And suddenly there was this extraordinary voice, and I've never seen anything like it. And then at a certain point, as she tells me, I said to her, you know, you should direct this. And she had been trying to figure out how to sell herself as director. And I had forgotten that story, but it was always going to be like that. And I think properly like that, properly because of what I said about what we do there, and very much because of this woman, because Kelly's a real deal.
So when did it evolve for you from I'm a writer to I can bring people in, I can change things besides myself and what I'm doing every day?
I'm a writer. I mean, that's what I am. And I work in writing rooms, and I work with just one writer and just talk, and, you know, but it's all about the writing.
Has it changed a lot over the last 30 years?
Which?
The whole experience of working with writers and writing yourself and...
No, that doesn't change.
I
don't think that changed from when you chiseled the words. I mean, you know, it's...
It was always the same work. It was just...
It's...
And always the same amount of joy for you?
always the same amount of righteousness for me. You can question a lot of these. You can, it's, in other words, when you go through the agonies of writing, you know, and I don't go through them. Kelly went through them. I watch them, and I'm there to do whatever I do. But when I go through the agonies of writing as a writer, it always seems righteous. You know, if you go through the agonies of whatever it is to do business, it doesn't always seem righteous. And I don't feel that way about anything else. Mm. I think, you know, that's.
So when you decided to be a writer director, was that just protecting your own work?
Yes, exactly. Yes. I mean, I could try and say a lot, but I think you just said it perfectly. Mm. I think I never had a great desire to be a director. But when as a producer in television, I control my work. Mm-hmm. The only way you control your work in movies is, you know, is that.
So did it feel natural to you getting behind the camera and directing?
It felt natural. It felt well. First of all, you get so much help all the time when you direct. Mm-hmm. But it felt natural to me because in television, you know, I got spoiled in the right way. You know, it was, you know, you run the set. Mm-hmm. You know, I was just speaking to Kira, who you've spoken with about, she just directed for the first time, but she had a show where she was the central thing and she ran it. Mm-hmm. And that's, because the big transition that people have to fight is, you know, you can, if you're around in the background of movies and somebody's directing, you know what she should do now. And that's so different than saying, do this. Mm-hmm. You know, that's a hard thing to get over. And if you've had time in television, which I did, it's not a hard thing to get over.
So we have Twitter now, and we have all these other social media and everything. But I mean, how have you felt the impact of your work in the world prior to all that? I mean, broadcast news, many of your films are iconic and, you know, impactful, so are your TV shows.
You know, if I understand your question correctly, David Geffen, who's one of the smartest people ever to be in this business, once said to me, because I had a picture that was successful, but I was going through some stuff that I wasn't happy with it in some way, and David Geffen says the only get off that counts on a movie is the one you give yourself, you know, and either you give it to yourself or you don't, and it's just one of those sentences you hear in life where you say, okay, that's what I take back down the mountain. And that's what I decided. And in this picture, which has been, just the spirit of the work, the passion, the everybody on my end, you know, just everybody working for free, the integrity, the passion, just trying to get it right, and just serving the movie, and at a certain point, as early in the process as I've ever gone, I think it was couple of previews in, I said, you know, this is a good movie. I'm really glad. And, you know, and you care about all the stuff that's going to happen now, one way or the other. And we are a putt-putt boat going against battleships when we open and stuff like that. But it's so great because Kelly happened and Hayden happened and Woody was wonderful. And all the actors enjoyed their experience, and it couldn't have happened without all of them. And it doesn't get better than that.
So is the struggle part of the pleasure? Does the struggle increase the pleasure?
The struggle is part of the service to what you're doing. You know, the thing I believe so much is that you push and push and push, and then you lose self-consciousness because suddenly there's a movie forming and the movie's the boss, and no one of you controls it anymore. You're all in service to it.
Though I assume you live in a world on some level, or have over the last 30, 40 years, that of people who want to make you happy and want you to do your work and want to have what you are in some way.
I pity the person who has the job of making me happy. I don't think there's been a long line of applicants for that job.
Are you hard to please?
No, you go nuts. I mean, you know, you can call it whatever you want to do. But there was a guy named Steve Gordon, who was a great comedy writer,
he
was a good friend of mine, and he did Arthur. That was the only movie he got to do. He died very young,
before it was released, right? Wasn't it right before?
No,
it was released right after.
No, after somewhat after he'd had the success of it.
Yeah,
and I and And I was in charge of a television show where he had gotten, I think he sold his first script. It might have been Steve's first script. Mm-hmm. And I was there. And, you know, on a television show, on a multi-camera show, you know, you have all the chairs with writers, and they do the whole thing. Steve was on a set for the first time in his life, you know, and he said they're standing in the wrong place. And it wasn't funny where they were standing, and where Steve said they should move to the first time he was on a set in his life was funny.
So he just knew.
Yeah. So, I mean, whatever you want to call that.
That instinct.
Yeah, whatever you want to call it. And writers have it, because writers hear it a certain way, and they see it when they, you know, you're seeing something when you're writing. You're hearing something when you're writing.
So how did Albert Brooks talk you into being an actor?
By lying to me. He said it would be fun.
It wasn't fun at all?
I was the worst actor to work with. First of all, it was very important, because you can't direct an actor without... I mean, you can, and people do, but once you feel the vulnerability of being an actor, once somebody, you know, so I was the guy who said, oh, can I have another take? And I was the guy when Albert came to the to his trailer the next day, I was waiting for him. I know, can't we go? I was that guy. Mm. And it was great to feel that.
Mm. Are there any golden eras of, I mean, it sounds like you live in the moment. It sounds like you're living in what is happening in front of you. There's certainly plenty of happy memories that you could be lingering in.
Oh man, I'm living around 8 minutes from now.
And that's how you've lived through the whole thing?
I rarely see anything I've ever made after I've made it. Rarely. Mm. I mean, it's always by accident, and it's always a curiosity when I do, and sometimes an interesting curiosity, but I just don't do that. I've had a show on the air. I'm blessed with a show on the air for past 25 years.
It's hard to avoid your shows almost and turn on the TV.
And I don't think there's an alternative to that. I mean, any alternative to being present is. I don't know. It's not. Maybe a graceful life means something different than being present. That's possible. Mm. I get. You know, I'm not sure. I don't think I have a graceful life.
Mm. So when does a movie end for you, or a show? Check out when it's over. Or?
Well, you know, you could. You know what? Hollywood has a way of always moving the finish line, even if a movie's successful. Mm. If you get this happening this week, this will be, you know. So I always said, you know, that you never get out a whoopee in Hollywood, because, oh, if we just do this, it'll really be that, and it'll really be. So you go whoa, 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 and then and you never get the pee out. Okay, this picture I have given myself the whoopee of.
Is it easier because it's not as because somebody else directed it, or somebody else wrote
maybe,
it?
Maybe, but it's an early whoopee for me in any event, you know. I think it's that David Geffen comment that's in my mind. This is, I mean, you know, Haley, I think, is the actor of her generation. I do. Kelly's these women are going to be giving us great movies. Hayden's going to be around, you know? Mm. Woody, the other actors are happy with what they've done, man. What are you waiting for your whoopee?
So how many times have you given yourself the whoopee?
Boy.
In your long career?
You know, in a sense, I think of two instances. I can think of the pilot of a series that didn't end up being successful, and I can think of
the associates.
The
associates.
Yes, that's great that you know that. That's amazing.
I'm old. I'm old enough to remember.
This, not everybody that age knows that show. But the pilot, we just solved. We got one of the great jokes late in the game that sort of nailed the initial episode. The cast was so exciting, and I remember having an electric moment. And then when I won an Academy Award, I went back to my seat and it was sitting there, and I don't know whether whoopee is the word, but it was it was like weird. It was like that. It was like weird. It was like
Because you're part of the family, or because somebody noticed, or
because it was surreal. It was like,
I mean, I literally still in my life probably quote broadcast news once a week at least, maybe 3 or 4 times a week.
Same
on
line?
A given week. No, different lines all the time. I have like different segments of that movie that I still cherish, and it's not the only thing of yours that I cherish that way. But it's you know, that particularly comes up, and even you know certainly. Albert's, I say it here and it comes out there, it comes up all the time with people in this business. But there are things like that that are seminal to people like me.
Somebody asked me today, what in my career I was proudest of. You know, it was not a question, you know, that I, and I, but today, being, what's the date today?
Today is... What is it? October 30, 29th?
Okay, October 29th. It's important. 2016. It's an important day. Today I said the devil speech in broadcast news.
Well, it's still one of the great...
Well, today I feel it. Today I feel the devil may be upon us.
And you have that... I mean, Mary Tyler Moore Show, obviously, is kind of like still one of the giant things, and people are still rerunning all the time. Do you have... Is it a very far ago memory that you don't even think about anymore? Or
It was. You know, I think about Grant Tinker, who was the head of that company, and how great an executive he was, and how he protected us, and how he believed in writers, and how he fought the networks on our behalf, and how magnificent it was to work for that guy for 7 years, and when he gave birth to a production company that did so much quality television. And we all adored him, and we were all relatively new to the business. So it's a great way to start in the business, you know, being protected and adoring the person who's giving it to you.
And you take pride in the fact that that show, as The Simpsons has in some ways in this generation, seeded a generation of TV writers?
No, I don't think it's... Well, the writers who move on and do their own shows, yeah. It's great. You know, the Charles Brothers did Cheers, and, you know, just... It's great. It's, you know, that's great, yeah.
Mm. But you don't take a lot of it for yourself?
It's not, I mean, I you know, it's not, it's, everybody works, everybody does their job, and you're lucky they're doing that great job for you, and then they get to, you know, it's nice. It's a feeling of, of community.
And you take
I do love the feeling of community when it happens, yeah.
And do you take the knocks? Any harder, or do those also?
I take the knocks as physical injuries that need a healing process.
But you heal,
huh?
You're a good healer.
I'm a slow healer.
Because I'm still waiting to see the musical version of I'll Do Anything.
I try to do it as a documentary because I thought it would be so meaningful to do something that where I had such a rough time, such a tremendously traumatic time, and do a documentary about the experience of doing something like that. And I couldn't get the music right, so I wasn't able to do it.
Maybe now the prince has passed, it'll change. But I mean, it's like it's kind of like the Holy Grail. It's like people looking for. What's his name, Orson Welles' Othello or something, and, you know, trying to put the pieces together because the film, you can feel the music in that film.
Yeah, yeah.
And you kind of miss it, and yet, who knows? I mean, it's kind of almost like an alluring idea.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, I did feel the passion to do it. I did spend months trying to get it off its feet. When I couldn't get the music right, life moves on.
Mm. So you're over 50 now?
Yeah.
Do you... see the next 20 yep. years of doing this more like shepherding something like Edge of 17? Or do you want to go in there and fight every day for the writing? Or
I fight every day for the writing with my day job on The Simpsons. Mm-hmm. And
which you're still doing as daily, really around that every day, pretty much still?
Yeah, yeah, I'm very active on the show, yeah. It's a great job. And you know, part of life is, please, I want to find a great job. I have a great job. But I have a script that I've been working on for, you know, my length of time, which unfortunately is a long time. Mm-hmm. I had to suspend it for a while when we did this, and I went back to it, and I'm devoted to it.
Do you miss directing? I mean, is it something you have an itch to do, or just it's the script and you're writing and...
No, writing. I mean, the directing, I love working with actors. I love working with actors. And it's not like I miss it, but whenever I do it again under any circumstances, I love it. I loved seeing the acting take you know happen in this movie. I loved being around the editing process of this of these performances. I loved watching these performances take shape. I think the casting was so imperative. This movie would not have gotten made or shouldn't have gotten made if four different people you know didn't do the parts they did. So
you always loved process? I mean, you've always been interested in that. Whether it's the three-camera show or the
Mary Tyler Moore show, which I think was my college, there was this great cast, and all of them had come from different disciplines, from traditional acting, like in Cloris's case, where she was you know group theater and all that, to Second City, to story theater, and it was my college because I talked to them endlessly. I think I was on that show for 7 years, and I don't think there was a year that I wasn't interviewing them about their experiences, and how they work as an actor, and that was great, and it's a mystery to me, and I still one of my pleasures is you know there's a this great acting coach, and whenever I can and sit in the back of that class, I still, you know, it's amazing, It's especially the people who you know sort of the school of acting that Stella Adler was a great you know acting teacher of the past and would have been one of the great directors if they had accepted women as directors then. I before I directed my first film I went to one of her last classes, and they were doing and somebody not very funny a girl not very funny was doing Barefoot in the Park, and she was. Berating the girl for what she was wearing, and she said, "What season is it?" She says, "Winter. You're not dressed right. What season is it?" And the girl said, "Winter," and she said, "I'm dressed for winter." She says, "You're not dressed for a Neil Simon winter," and then she started to put clothes on her and making this girl funny, and just watching. And the other night I was watching Larry Moss, who's the teacher I'm talking about. I was at his class in New York just the other night. And he had two actors working on Noel Coward, and he's a great acting teacher. Mm-hmm. I saw him spend 45 minutes trying to get them to nail a joke, and I said, "Wow, man! You know, it's just, you know, the humility of that, and the necessity of that. And there's nobody who directs comedy who wouldn't identify with what I'm saying right now."
So every day, every joke, every situation calls on that kind of focus.
Yeah. Well, it is what you do. It is what you're supposed to be doing, I think.
Right. But it never gets easy. It never gets rote.
Well, sometimes it's easy. Sometimes I did the Tracy Ullman show, which gave birth to The Simpsons, and we had Mel Brooks on. And directing Mel Brooks for me was he'd do something and I'd fall on the floor laughing. He'd do something, I'd convulse laughing. Yes, that does happen.
So Mel makes it easy.
And I've worked with great actors, and it's thrilling. Mm-hmm. It's thrilling. It's not like pulling teeth. It's thrilling. It's the standard story. You have a scene to do that day in a movie. Two actors, they're on their way to the studio, and they think the scene's going to go this way. You're the director or writer. You're going there thinking it'll go, and then something happens that nobody anticipated. That's it.
That's what it's all about.
That's what it's all about.
And all.
Well, and it's great if that happens. When it's great, you know.
And the thing of
there's also the reverse of that is that nobody gets anything, you know.
And the idea of letting yourself get the win and all that is that I mean you.
What does that mean?
Well, I mean the comment you quoted before about allowing yourself the
whoopee.
The whoopee, yes. Uh-huh. You've had, I mean, by a lot of standards, maybe not your own, you've had a lot of whoopee. Do you push that aside? Do you have to not live in the money, the success, the freedom that it brings, the things, all those things that, okay, you live in a nice house, but
you get whoopies real and false all the time. You know, you write a line, you think it's great, and the next day you think it's crummy, but you've had your whoopee from the moment you wrote the line. You're in a writer's room, and you're struggling on something, and suddenly somebody says something where everybody laughs. It's a whoopee, yeah.
But you always live in the humility of a writer.
I haven't found the alternative yet. I'll take it. Anybody gives me the alternative to that, I'll take it.
Excellent. Thank you so much for your time. I appreciate it.
It was just interesting, man. Thank you. You do. You do this so great that it's uncomfortable.
No.